Good morning and welcome back to the second meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee in 2023. Those of you who joined earlier will have known that we moved on to agenda item 4 as the Cabinet Secretary had been unavoidably detained, I believe, in traffic. So we're now back in session, moving on to agenda item 2, which is budget scrutiny. And this is an evidence session on the Scottish Budget 23-24. And I refer members to the papers under that item. On the 15th of December, the Scottish Government published its annual budget, which sets out its tax and planning and spending plans for the coming year. Today we're joined by Michael Matheson, Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero Energy and Transport, to explore the budget within his portfolio. I'd like to welcome you, Cabinet Secretary, and thank you also for your reply just before Christmas to our pre-budgetary letter, elements which I expect may come up as we discuss things this morning. I'd also like to welcome Simon Fuller, the Deputy Director of Rural Environmental Science and Analytical Services from the Scottish Government, John Rathjen, the Deputy Director for Water Policy and Director for Energy and Climate Change Operations from the Scottish Government, and Kerry Twyman, the Director of Finance and Corporate Services for Transport Scotland. Thank you all for attending. We've allocated around 90 minutes for this item. But before we start with questions, Cabinet Secretary, I believe you'd like to make a brief opening statement.
Good morning and thank you, Convener. My apologies for being delayed this morning in arriving for the committee's session. The portfolio draws together many of the key strands required to deliver on this government's ambitious and world-leading plans around climate change, biodiversity and transition to net zero, whilst continuing to support the most vulnerable in society and deliver a safe, accessible and affordable public transport system. Our 2023-24 budget comes against a difficult financial backdrop as we work collectively to tackle the acute cost crisis facing the country while managing inflationary pressures across our budgets. This has required reprioritisation towards those programmes that most effectively deliver on our key outcomes. The 2023-24 budget will spend over £3.5 billion on transport, including investment of over £1.4 billion to maintain, improve and decarbonise Scotland's rail network, including the provision of £15 million to allow the exploration of a pilot looking into the removal of peak time rail fares as part of our Fair Fares review. We will invest £426 million to support bus services and their users, providing access to free bus travel for over 2 million people, including all under 22s. We will continue to increase our investment in walking, wheeling and cycling, allocating £190 million in the 2023-24 budget, as well as spending £440 million to support our Lifeline ferry services, connecting our vital island communities and supporting priority harbour projects. And we're providing record investment to protect and restore nature, including our peatlands, and to tackle the causes of biodiversity loss. We'll also continue to support our forestry bodies to deliver the Woodlands Creation Target, which will see 16,500 hectares of new planting in 23-24. We recognise that substantial investment is needed in delivering on our waste and recycling targets. In this budget, we are investing over £47 million to drive Scotland's circular economy, reducing reliance on scarce resources and reducing waste. And we are committed to taking strong action to meet the climate challenge, investing over £81 million on climate action, including through the Just Transition Fund, to accelerate the development of a transformed and decarbonised economy in the North East and Moray. And finally, we will continue to provide significant budget for energy to make our homes and buildings warmer, greener and more energy efficient, and increasing funding to help support the fuel poor through our heat transition, In the short term, we will continue with our fuel insecurity fund next year with some £20 million of investment. Convener, the portfolio budget delivers on an ambitious agenda, but it's not without risk, such as the ongoing impact of COVID on public transport patronage and revenue, and inflationary pressures across the portfolio impacting significantly on areas such as pay, infrastructure projects and contracts. I can, however, reassure the committee that I will continue to reprioritise within my budget, not only to meet our legal, statutory and contractual commitments, but to achieve value for money against a challenging financial position. And of course, I'm happy to respond to any questions the committee have.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. The first questions are going to come from Monica Lennon. Monica.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the Cabinet Secretary and his officials. I want to begin by asking about the Fair Fares review, and there's been a lot of public interest in peak rail fares and the announcement around the abolition of peak rail fares as part of the Fair Fares review. So given that public interest and the committee's interest, Cabinet Secretary, could you explain the rationale behind abolishing peak rail fares? And as some people have pointed out, that rail travel is most frequently used by men, people in higher incomes and older age groups. Can you provide some comment on the socio-economic rationale behind this decision?
Okay, so the Fair Fare review actually stems back to our national transport strategy, when it was one of the key priorities we set out that we would take forward as an area of reviewing our transport policy moving forward. And the Fair Fare review was to look at how we can address aspects of what are anomalies within the fare structure, so whether it be in rail or in ferries or in buses, that we're trying to identify ways in which we can remove these anomalies, and how we can also look at trying to streamline some of the ways in which fares are set within different transport modes. So that's the background to where the Fair Fare review actually comes from. However, the National Transport Strategy was published pre-COVID, and since then one of the most significant things that's happened has been the big change in patronage on public transport, which has continued to this point where we haven't saw full recovery, particularly in areas such as rail, in patronage levels. And the idea behind having a pilot in removing peak fares is to see whether this would help to make public transport and rail, in this case, more attractive to more people making use of it, and to test that out as a hypothesis of potentially it could have a positive impact. So the £50 million that we've allocated in the budget will provide for that. We're now taking forward a range of work to identify the most appropriate way in which to carry out the pilots, because it's important that we do it in a way that is meaningful and that we can be confident in the outcome and the findings that come from that. So there's quite a bit of detailed work going on behind the scenes between Transport Scotland and ScotRail in looking at trying to identify an appropriate route for the pilot. The Fair Fare review overall, though, should be completed in the spring of this year, which we then intend to set out some of the proposals that have come through the review process, which will involve a public consultation exercise as well, which will allow stakeholders, Parliament and the public to have a say on some of the findings from the Fair Fare review and some of the work that we're planning to take forward, and alongside that carrying out the issue of the pilot on the peak fares. In terms of socio and economic, well, if you want to look at in terms of public transport from a socio-economic point of view, the vast majority of people making use of public transport is on bus. And we're now at the point where almost half the population in Scotland are able to travel on the buses for free, which obviously has a significant financial benefit to those who make regular use of bus. If you want to focus in areas that will help people in lower incomes accessing public transport, I would suggest to you that bus would be the number one priority, given the social demographic profile of those who make use of buses and the significant numbers that make use of them compared to rail. which is why we're now at the point where, as I say, almost half the country now are able to travel for free on buses in Scotland.
Thank you. Yeah, keen to come on to buses in a moment, but sticking with rail and the six-month pilot that we're talking about in terms of peak rail fares, does government hope that that measure will help to widen access, and will there be any work done during the pilot or in advance of it to make people aware so that we can see more people from different backgrounds using rail?
Yeah, I do. I think this is why we've got to be quite careful, and we've got to take our time in making sure that we run the right pilot, because I think there's a danger here that that you could spend £50 million running a pilot where at the end of it we say, well, patronage levels have increased, but actually is it just people who were always going to return to use rail anyway? Is it the same people who were already using rail anyway as well? Is it making it more accessible to those on lower incomes as a result? So we need to be quite careful making sure that it's meaningful, and that's why the work that's been taken forward by officials in Transport Scotland and with ScotRail, I think, is going to have to demonstrate how we can make sure the pilot is going to provide us with the level of data and understandings we're looking for. So I want us to take our time to make sure we make the right choices here and it with the right processes in place to be able to evaluate it effectively. Otherwise, we'll lose that opportunity.
Okay, that's helpful. Can you tell us a bit more about how the Community Bus Fund will work in practice and what funds will be available this year, and how can it help local authorities to establish municipal bus companies?
So within, I think there's in the region of just over £60 million being provided to help support bus services, which includes an element for the Community Bus Fund. I think the overall figure here is, there's a provision which is £5 million of capital funding and also £1 million of resource funding, which is accessible to local authorities to look at developing initiatives aligned with the powers that are within the 2019 Transport Act. So that could look at franchising model, they could look at running their own bus services. So the funding we've provided for bus in the next financial year has a provision which is specifically to support local authorities in developing proposals and to work through some of the details and how they might want to develop them with the powers in the Transport Act.
Okay. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I mean, you said yourself, you know, how important bus services, you know, are to yeah. our communities, and also, you know, in terms of net zero, which is this committee's focus. Do you feel, or does the Scottish Government feel, that enough progress is being made in establishing municipal bus companies in Scotland? And what further action can the Scottish Government take to support this development? Because we know there are funding pressures. You've given us you've itemised some of the amounts here, £5 million capital, £1 million resource, I mean, spread across all the local authorities. I don't know how far that actually goes, but are you content with the level of progress being made so far?
Well, just to be clear as well, it's £62.5 million that we're providing in support to bus services. Of that, there is that £1 million resource and £5 million capital within it to support councils on looking at providing bus services in their area. I think I'd like to have seen faster progress. I'd like to have seen more, because I actually... bus is the most flexible form of mass public transport you can get. So, it's a very flexible resource, and one which I think is a real priority for us, and that's reflected in our policy programme. I think it's important that we allow local authorities to look at what's the most appropriate model for their area. So what might work in a big urban area won't necessarily be effective in a more rural area, and there are a number of different options available to local authorities. So one of the areas that I think a number of local authorities are interested in is franchising and having a franchise service within their area, which allows them to set down the services that they want, the frequency to which they wish the services, and also the fare rates at which they are set as well. so it gives them much more control. What it does is it removes the need for them to actually own and actually run buses, but they actually control the service. So it takes away a lot of the capital costs which is associated with running a service. And we need to allow local authorities the space to be able to look at identifying what would be the best way for them to go about doing that. So the funding that we're providing is to support them in actually developing some of that work. I think it'd be fair to say as well, though, that the bus industry has also gone through a really difficult time during the course of COVID as well, and patronage levels haven't fully returned to the levels that they were at previously as well, which is causing them financial challenges. So I think it's in all of our interest to find a much more sustainable approach. If you were to ask me, is the existing model working in our interest? No, it's not. Which is why I think the provisions we're putting in the Act give us options to go forward, and I'd like to start to see some of those options being developed and becoming active models that are being used. And hopefully over the course of the next couple of years, we'll start to see that happening.
Thank you. And you mentioned industry.
That's a good question on that. Just to clarify a point, I'm just concerned looking at the future for buses and local authorities. I mean, the cost of electric bus seems to vary between £800 and £1 million. So is there going to be a massive demand if local authorities go for electric buses? You know, it's not going to be one. It's going to be hundreds of buses that are required. How's that going to be funded if that's your preferred option going forward? Sorry, I'm just looking to the future.
Well, it depends. So if a local authority is looking to develop an ownership model, a municipal bus service, then there are all the capital costs which are associated with that, for example, purchasing buses, running garages, etc., for their maintenance, which is why I think a number of local authorities are looking at the other model, which is actually a franchising model, which is where you go into a franchise agreement with a bus operator to provide those services within your area, and you specify the services which you want and the frequency and the timetable, etc. Some of the way in which it has operated in rail to some extent.
So just to clarify, what you're suggesting is that it would be more on the London buses type prototype than actual ownership by councils.
Yeah, so there's a few local authority areas in metropolitan areas in England that have already got bus franchises. I think Manchester's got one in place. I think there's a number of other big cities have got franchising models in place as well. So it's not. I'm not saying that's the model they should go. What I'm saying is that from engagement I've had from local authorities, some of them actually are looking much more at the franchising model rather than actually looking at setting up their own bus company instead, because of all of the capital costs which are associated with that. So it's a different model, and I think what the funding we're providing through the bus support funding is to allow local authorities to look at developing some of these models and to put more flesh in the bones around what they're thinking of doing and how they might want to take that forward.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Monica, sorry to interrupt you.
That's okay, Convener, not a problem. Cabinet Secretary, you mentioned industry, so keen to know if Transport Scotland has undertaken any research or engaged with bus operators to establish that the level of funding provided through the Network Support Grant is sufficient to maintain and develop bus services across Scotland.
So we're obviously going into a phase where the COVID support is coming to an end for the bus services, for bus operators, and we've been engaging with CPT to identify a mechanism through the new bus support mechanism, which is replacing BSOG, in order to deliver a sustainable model for them, and one that also works for the taxpayer as well. That work's ongoing at the present moment. I don't think it has been concluded, but I can reassure you we are engaging with the industry around looking at how we shape that new scheme going forward to try and manage the transition into a new funding model from the previous BSOG grant system.
Thank you. And just last question. Cabinet Secretary, are you familiar with the term bus deserts? That's a term that we're hearing more and more about. Communities are quite pleased that there's more opportunity to have free bus travel, but it's not any good to you if there's no bus to get on, or it's not running at a time that suits you to get to work or to get to school or to get around your daily business. So is that forming part of this ongoing research and development? Is this term bus deserts. Is that worrying to you?
Yeah. Look, there's no point in having a bus pass if you can't get access to a bus. So, and I recognise the challenges that communities have. In our rural communities are probably more adversely impacted than some of our urban communities where there are alternative options available. So I recognise that, which is why, when I made the point is that I don't think the existing model is sustainable. And I think COVID has actually brought that into even more sharp relief, which is why an alternative approach is necessary, and where I think the pillars within the Transport Act can actually deliver a much more sustainable, consistent form of public transport. If we're to make public transport attractive to people, it needs to be safe and reliable, and it needs to also be priced at a level which people feel is affordable as well, to make it attractive to them. So I think over the course of the next couple of years, there's a big opportunity to reset the way in which bus services are provided in the country. And I'm encouraged from some of the engagement that's been taking place with local authorities who are increasingly determined to look at how they can change the model operating in their area. And I think there is the potential to change the way in which services are operating quite considerably.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Monica. Liam, I think you've got some questions you'd like to ask now. Liam.
Yes, thank you, Convener. Good morning. Just a couple of questions, Cabinet Secretary, on electric vehicle charging. Firstly, the Climate Change Committee considers that we need 30,000 public EV charge points in Scotland by 2030. We've currently got fewer than 3,000, I think, and your written evidence to this committee confirmed you don't have a target for the installation, or certainly not the 30,000 that we understand we require. Do you think, Cabinet Secretary, that the lack of a target could have a negative impact on your ability to set budgets in this area for installation and to actually plan and ultimately deliver on a comprehensive rollout?
So we've got over 3,000 public charging points in Scotland. That doesn't include the number of private charging points. So there will be several thousand private charging points, including charging points that have been put into workplaces, etc., which are not part of the public sector networks. So there's a distinction there. So the 3,000 plus figure is public sector charging points. I'm not sure whether if you included. I don't know what the figure is for private sector, but it will be several thousand on top of that which are available. And that's a growing network as well. What we've given a commitment to do is to double the public sector charging network. So from the 3,000+ that we've got at the moment to over 6,000 units over the course of the next couple of years. And we've allocated £30 million to support that. And we're working with the private sector to lever in an additional £30 million in order to help to deliver on that expansion of the network. So I believe a combination of further private sector investment, which I think we'll see continuing to grow alongside the public sector investment, the public charging network, will give us sufficient coverage for the charging network overall. I'm conscious, I've heard this figure a number of times, the 30,000 charging places that the CCC believe is necessary. I'm not entirely sure how that figure has been arrived at. So, but we believe actually that combination of public and private combination will provide us with sufficient coverage, alongside also looking to encourage people to make greater use of public transport as well.
And on that exact point about the public-private, there was a written response that came back to the convener's letter of 10th of November, which states that the Scottish Government intends to deliver £60 million of public and private investment to at least double the size of Scotland's public charging network, just as you've discussed. Can you tell the committee how much of that £60 million do you expect to come from public sector investment, from which budget line and over what period?
It's £30 million is coming from the public sector budget. And it is over, what's the timeline that's over, do you know, Kerry?
I believe it's the next year or two.
And it's part of a programme of what we've taken.
I didn't hear that because your microphone didn't come on, sorry.
Sorry.
Don't worry, the gentleman will push it. I just missed it. Sorry, I'm slightly deaf, so it would help just to repeat that, Kerry, if you would, please.
So we've got budget availability over this forthcoming financial year and the financial year after that, depending on how fast delivery is required.
So this is a piece of work we're taking forward with, which we've been working with the Futures Trust on, to look at levering in private sector investment, and that engagement is ongoing just now. That's where the total of the £60 million comes from, both public and private together, but £30 million from the public sector.
I understand. Very grateful. Thank you.
Thank you. Jackie Dunbar, you've got some questions. Jackie.
Thank you. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and to your officials. I'm going to ask some questions regarding the Scottish Government's response to the energy price rises, you know, the report that was done. In your response to the committee's pre-budget letter, you list that the home and energy efficiency programmes that have been expanded due to the response to the queries on the escalating retrofitting this winter. Can I ask what the impact has been so far on the take-up of these programmes and also on the fuel poverty rates?
So we've gone through a period here where demand, it would be fair to say, because it's a demand-led budget, demand hasn't quite kept pace with budget allocation. But what which meant that the level of demand wasn't quite utilising all of the budget that was available to it, through whether it be the Warmer Homes programme or the area-based scheme as well. There was a number of reasons for that. Two of the reasons that have been highlighted to us from the sector was a combination of actual skills and actual materials that had an impact in delivering in some of the programmes. What we have also done is to try and help to raise greater public awareness. So back in November last year, we started a publicity campaign to help to highlight greater awareness of the schemes and the availability of the schemes and how people can access them as well. Since then, we've seen a bit of an uptick in demand growing as well. And what we're also seeing from the industry is looking to try and also to develop the breadth of skills that they need to help to drive forward some of these programmes. So we're seeing a slight uptick, and we're also planning a further public information programme later this year in order, again, to highlight people about the scope of the programme. The purpose behind this, obviously, is to help to reduce fuel poverty. So the cheapest form of fuel that you can actually get is a fuel you don't use. So greater efficiencies is a key part of that, and both the Warmer Homes, the Home Energy Scotland programme, the Business Energy Scotland programme, and also the area-based schemes are all about reducing energy demand and making properties more efficient. But that's going to be a continued area of priority over the course of the coming years, not just this financial year, given the need to help to reduce fuel poverty and reduce the demand for energy going forward.
How do you think that we can maybe upskill the industry, so to speak, to ensure that we do have the proper skills in place?
So when I mentioned broadly two areas, skills and also materials, so for a variety of different reasons. So some of the issue around materials was just because of the close down you had in some parts during the course of the pandemic, and as demand has started to uplift, there's been challenges in getting access to some materials. So that's been one aspect of the challenge as well, but it's not so much a challenge now it's not as much of an issue now. The other issue is around is access to skills. So there is a real constraint on labour in the sector. There is no doubt about that. I think I may have said at this committee before, I remember, in a discussion with one of the companies that's involved in the area-based scheme programme in the Central Belt, that basically we're really struggling to recruit staff into helping them roll out the programme even faster. And a principal reason for that is because they lost access to a significant number of staff they had from Eastern Europe. So they no longer have access to that staff. So they've got an apprenticeship-based scheme where they try to train people to hold people in the industry. But they flagged up to me is that, I think to paraphrase, it was like you could double the budget, but I won't be able to actually utilise it because I don't have access to skills despite the training we're doing, the work we're doing in industry, because we've lost access to labour from Eastern Europe, which is constraining them. So that has a direct impact on them. That's a fact. There's no getting away from that. So we have to make sure that we are working with the training organisations, with the industry and our colleges to make sure that we are focus on the skills that are necessary to help to support these industries going forward. But labour constraints is a significant issue still.
Okay. You said earlier about the uptake on the programmes where it was lower than what you'd hoped for it to be. Can I ask if the demand for the uptake of the programmes continue, you know, going forward, do you have any contingency plans for how the funding could be used? Or, you know, will the low uptake have an effect on the funding allocation in future years?
So we have in the past, where there has been an underspend, been able to reallocate that budget and reutilise that budget. So it's not lost in that sense. But what we can do is through greater public awareness and understanding is to help to promote the schemes and the programmes to try and help to encourage more people to take up the options that are available to them, whether it be for domestic premises or for business premises. I know, for example, my own constituency, I've flagged up to a number of businesses that are experiencing very significant energy challenges because of big increase in price, that through the Business Energy Scotland programme, there may be loans available to them for them to make investment in. And I know, I won't mention by name, but I know one of them is at a very advanced stage in actually looking at putting in solar panel systems, which is part of that programme to reduce their energy costs because they're an energy intensive business. So I think continuing that public awareness and business awareness is really important. I think it'd be fair to say probably the last year has given people a much greater focus on their energy costs in a way that they previously weren't necessarily as focused on. And I think there is an opportunity to make sure we're driving forward energy efficiency as part of how we can reduce energy demand in the future as well.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks very much, Jackie. Now, the Deputy Convener, I think, had some questions on this subject. Before you move off this subject, I'd like to bring Mark Ruskell in after you, if I may. So I'll come to you first, Deputy Convener, and then Mark. So, Fiona.
Okay, good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I'm quite aware that probably compared to other portfolios, your budget is more subject to market conditions out with your control. Right, I appreciate that. But particularly still on the issue of energy efficiency, we knew back in April when we started our inquiry, it was public that there would be increased prices in energy. I'm concerned it took to November to start publicising to increase demand for the programmes that we had. So, bearing in mind we've reported back in July, why has it taken so long to ramp up the stimulation of demand when we know there's obviously an absolute need for it because of the current energy crisis? And if we can't do it in a year that we have, how convinced are you that going forward, your allocation of budget, however large it is, will be able to be utilised properly to get the pace of home energy efficiency that we need going forward?
So I think if you look back in earlier last year, we actually ran a public information campaign which was about people having challenges with their energy bills and the range of help and support that was available to them. And within that, there was provision for energy efficiency measures. So that was part of a wider government programme. What we ran in November was something very specific, which was around this programme in itself to try and help to create greater awareness on it. Because the level of demand that we were seeing wasn't in the line with what we expected it to be. Yeah. I don't know why that was the case. So it's not that we weren't doing nothing in terms of making people aware of it, but we actually did even more in November and we're going to do more this year going forward. I don't know whether there was an element of a timeline between people getting their bills and the impact and seeing it sort of idea. I'm trying to think of my own personal circumstances is that there was almost a lag in it. You knew things were going to become much more expensive before it actually hit you. And I don't know where that had a bit of an impact in people thinking about it and it. It won't be as bad as people think it is. I don't know. But we had the public information campaign last year, which was about that wider cost challenge and the help and support that was available to people, including the website that we developed as well, which Shona Robson and the community side developed. But the November was very bespoke and specific around trying to get more people to understand what was available on the energy efficiency side. So I hope that reassures you it wasn't a case of doing nothing. It was just that we did something much more bespoke because we weren't seeing the level of uptick that we'd hoped for.
And could I just ask a question about the National Energy Agency from a budget point of view? Will there be new funding made available to finance that, or will that be top slice from other dedicated heat and energy efficiency funding programmes?
So we're getting into the space of negotiations with the Finance Secretary, so well, there's new funding for it. Right now it's absorbed within our existing funding within the climate change and energy side in government, because as you know it's working in a shadow basis at the present time. We've got the strategic board in place. They will be, over the course of this year, setting out much clearer actions that we need to take in order to create the dedicated body. And once we have a fuller understanding as to what exactly that structure will be like, we'll then be in a position to look at how we finance that. Whether that will be a combination of new funding or coming from existing funding will be determined once we get to that point. But at the present moment, it's been met from within our existing budgets.
Okay, I'm going to come to Mark Ruskell and then come back to you now in a minute, Fiona. So, Mark, if you'd like to go on.
Just to follow up on that, I mean, you mentioned earlier on, Cabinet Secretary, about the importance of area-based schemes, about really getting a scale of rollout. I mean, how important is the National Energy Agency in helping to deliver that? And is it possible to accelerate the development of the National Energy Agency? Because it feels like we could be waiting some time before it's absolutely up and running, it's up to full capacity, and it's able to kind of, you know, marshal some of the opportunities there for energy companies and councils and private sector to come in and do things at the kind of scale that we need.
Yeah, sorry. I think it's important to understand that it's not as though nothing is happening. So actually, although it's in-house at the present moment, there's a considerable amount of work being done by officials in working with local authorities, housing associations and other organisations on how we can actually look at collectively working together to deliver on some of these energy efficiency programmes, but also on alternative heating systems as well. So one of the things we've created is the heat networks unit within the directorate as well, which is playing an important part in helping to bring together expertise around local authorities. Housing associations are looking at heat networks as well. What the national agency will be able to do is to take that up onto a much more national scale through dedicated resources, staff, expertise to support local authorities, housing associations in taking forward these policy areas. So what we're trying to avoid is getting into a situation where every local authority is having to reinvent the wheel each time they try to develop a heat network, or a housing association is having to reinvent the wheel to try and get efficiencies around some of this. And to bring together that expertise and skills base that can support them in taking it forward. I think there is, you know, can we do it quicker? I think, you know, we've got fairly ambitious targets in what we're trying to take forward around heating buildings as it stands at the present moment. So, if there are ways in which we can see from the Committee on Climate Change's report at the end of last year about the infrastructure to ramp up our action in this area, if there are areas where we can speed up that process, then we won't be slow in making sure we do that. I hope I can give you reassurances that there's a considerable amount of work ongoing just now. We're not waiting for this standalone agency to be created in order to make sure we drive it forward.
Thank you. I'll come back to the Deputy Convener. Yeah.
Thank you. I want to move now on to hydrogen. The Hydrogen Action Plan states that production of renewable hydrogen from onshore renewables by the mid-decade is the key focus of our hydrogen investment programme in this parliamentary term. So does that mean that green hydrogen is taking priority over blue hydrogen for funding from the Scottish Government, or do you see blue hydrogen as a bridging technology to help support green hydrogen?
So this is an area which has changed dramatically in the course of the last year. So if we were having this discussion last year, I would suggest, Convener, that I would be saying to the committee that blue hydrogen would probably play quite a big part in the early development of the hydrogen economy. What has significantly changed over the course of last year is that because of wholesale gas prices, etc., but what's happened over the course of last year is that there's been a big switch in the sector and been much more focused on green hydrogen, because the cost of it and the potential production cost of it have dropped significantly, which means that you've got companies focusing who may have been looking at blue hydrogen previously are now looking at actually the cost base for doing green hydrogen has dropped sufficiently just to go straight to green hydrogen. Where I think blue hydrogen will continue to play a role is in the energy transition within some of our big energy-intensive sectors. So, for example, in Grangemouth. So they presently use grey hydrogen. I would see that you can see the plans INEOS have got to move towards blue hydrogen, which is aligned into the ACORN, the Scottish Cluster Project, as well. So for some of them, it will be a bridging technology before they then move to green hydrogen in itself. But I would say that the priority is going to be over the course of the coming years is going to be much more on green hydrogen. Not just because of that's what's happening here, it's because that's what's happening at a European-wide basis. So you can see now, for example, if you look at the repower programme from the EU, is that big focuses on low carbon, but big focuses on green hydrogen as being the priority going forward, that blue is seen as being a bridging technology in some energy-intensive sectors. So you can now see the pattern of travel, which is why in the Hydrogen Action Plan, you can see our focus is much more on green hydrogen going forward, potentially, particularly because of its export potential, because there is significant potential for us to be a major exporter of green hydrogen and also hydrogen derivatives, so ammonia, methanol, and also the development of liquid organic hydrogen carriers, which we are involved in work on with Rotterdam and the Net Zero Technology Centre. So I would say green hydrogen is becoming more and more of a focus and will play a bigger part than I would have said to you this time last year.
So bear in mind my previous remarks is market conditions has more of an impact on your portfolio than yeah. others. Sticking on green hydrogen, one of the issues is how do we in Scotland benefit from the potential jobs, and will your budget be allocated more for attracting inward investment that may or may not, depending on market conditions, and obviously we've got European and other competition in there, or will you be allocating funding to help generate Scottish-based companies to be able to produce hydrogen to secure jobs, and that's part of that just transition from the traditional energy sector?
So I think the first thing to say, though, is that the gateway to delivering on the hydrogen economy is onshore and offshore wind, so to provide the cheap renewable electricity. So our priority has got to be to make sure that we are creating the opportunities to produce the renewable electricity. That's one of the areas where Scotland is more advanced than many other European countries. So you will see many European countries and other countries beyond Europe setting very ambitious targets for the production of green hydrogen, but actually many of them don't have the renewable energy projects either in consent or consented or lease sites, etc. They're quite a bit behind us, which is why we've got an advantage here in some ways. Not, there are European countries that are in a good place, but we are one of the few that's got that has got, for example, Scotland leasing round has already been completed. If you somewhere like Norway, they've still to do that. So they are probably about 2 years behind us in that process. And they want to go into green hydrogen production in a big way as well. So that renewable energy element is really important. So one of the things that we have in the budget is that we are creating within the directorate is much more resource to help to support the consenting process for both on and offshore wind, but offshore wind in particular, so that we can deal with consents effectively and efficiently, while also dealing with the environmental aspects that go alongside that. So additional resources going in there in my directorate to support that. On the hydrogen element in particular, there's a number of pieces of work we're taking forward. So what will be really important here is that we don't just become a production basin, that we also become a manufacturing centre for the components and electrolysers, etc., that go into the production of green hydrogen, which reaches out with my portfolio, although I've got a direct interest in this, which is very much within the economy side. So my colleague Ivan McKee and I work very closely together in how we can maximise the opportunity to attract inward investment, but also to support businesses in Scotland that could pivot into hydrogen production to do so. So last year, I think it was last October, we published our hydrogen prospectus, which was our proposition, which sets out the opportunities for businesses in Scotland and also beyond to look at manufacturing capacity being developed here in Scotland. We've had quite a bit of engagement through SDI and through SE at an international level now, which has attracted quite a bit of interest, to be fair to say. And also we have had work being taken forward by account managers in SE with businesses that have engineering expertise but aren't necessarily in the hydrogen space in helping to make sure that they understand that actually you could pivot into this sector. So last October, we held an event in Edinburgh bringing together interested stakeholders, interested companies, both from the energy side but also from the manufacturing side, to discuss our proposition and to look at how we can scale up that opportunity. So there is now a considerable amount of work, and I think it's in one of, I think in the six key priorities, one of the six key priorities you probably know better than I that SE now have, is that hydrogen is one of them. So there's now a significant amount of resource from an SE SDI point of view and from trade policy point of view in seeing hydrogen as a major strategic priority for us going forward as well. And what we're now looking to do is that we've now got a specific piece of work that we're has been taken forward within my portfolio and also within the trade portfolio to look at making sure that we are dovetailing all of that work collectively together. We've got a further meeting in that this month. So we're combining the key elements of production capacity here in Scotland along in the energy side and businesses that want to go into it, alongside trade and investment opportunities and business growth opportunities, so it all starts to knit together in a way that's much more consistent and maximising the opportunity.
And,
sorry,
and just,
it's a bit of a long answer.
Yeah, it's very helpful for a wider context of the work of the committee. But my final question is on budget. So is it fair to say that in order for your hydrogen strategy to be effective, and the reliance particularly on offshore and onshore wind in terms of green hydrogen production, that the enablers in terms of spend are not within your budget? The prohibitors could be skills, could be in relation to planning consents, as you've talked about, and also for domestic company development so that Scottish companies can develop capacity. These actually lie in the portfolio, the economy portfolio, and what confidence have you got that the priorities for that spend to enable the energy generation that we've talked about are there? Because I suspect those budgets are under more pressure than your budget.
So you mentioned three areas of skills, domestic companies at a domestic level and planning. Planning not so much, because planning amongst will rest largely with us, so which is why in terms of offshore, because if you look at a lot of the big offshore developments that are planned over the course of the next 10 years, quite a number of them have hydrogen projects or potential hydrogen projects associated with them. So I'm very conscious of the need to make sure that we have got in place the right supports to support that. So there's actually some changes taking place within my directorate to facilitate that. That includes actually bringing in new staff, recruiting additional staff, and also a strategic lead at a director level in driving that forward. So that's happening just now, and the budget provides additional, it's £5 million of additional resource in there to support the development of this element. So that's the planning consenting aspects that sit within my portfolio. In terms of skills, I think there is a challenge there. Not just a challenge here in Scotland, it's a challenge globally. So if you look at over the course of the last year, 18 months, countries across the globe, but just let's just take Europe, the scaling up of offshore wind and onshore wind is quite marked. It's become all the more of a become a more of a priority during the challenges of the last year because of energy security issues. So I think there will be a number of challenges here. I think there will be a skills challenge because of just restrictions and access to labour in itself. I think there will also be a materials challenge. So some of the raw materials that are needed for the manufacturing of these products are going to become constrained because of the level of global demand that's going to be experienced. And I also think there will be a capacity constraint on industry in manufacturing some of these components as well, just given the level of demand that we're actually potentially going to see as well, which is why, in my view, having a very clear, effective consenting process is extremely important to give the industry confidence in the process that we have here in Scotland in rolling out these projects, to see it as being a priority area where they can be taken forward in a timely fashion. So I think there are going to be challenges there. It'd be fair to say, and I don't want to speak for Ivan McInnes, it'd be fair to say that I'm doing a lot of trade work as well now, because the whole energy area over the course of last year has just, 18 months has just increased dramatically. Demands on ministers from overseas governments to meet with us. Our businesses in Scotland looking to invest overseas as well has increased dramatically as well. When I was in Japan last year in November, a lot of it was about a combination of inward investment from Japanese companies here, but also Scottish companies investing in Southeast Asia in renewable energy as well. So that has scaled up very significantly. I know that Mr. McKee has found that challenging because of the demands it's placing on him, which is why I'm doing some of that work as well. And we've got other ministers who have been involved in it to take up some of that demand. In terms of budget provision, I think at this stage I'm comfortable that we've got sufficient budget provision to meet these demands. I think it's more about refocusing some of the staff who are involved in some of the broader energy work, being much more focused on the key areas that we need to prioritise at the present moment, rather than being a need for any more extra resources on top of that. And the work we're doing just now to try and bring together the trade, investment and energy aspects are all about trying to knit that together much more effectively to be much more focused and also much more efficient in how we're using our resources.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Fiona. Some questions now from Mark Ruskell. Mark.
Yeah, thanks very much, Convener. I wanted to switch a bit into the process of the development of the budget and the climate proofing of the budget and the implementation of the joint budget review on climate. So, firstly, it was welcome getting the letter, I think yesterday, just updating progress that government's making on this. I wanted to ask you about each of the three strands. So, if we could maybe take the first strand, which was introduced into this year's budget, which was the climate change narrative. I think very welcome seeing not just a carbon assessment, but much more of a narrative that explains some of the policy choices that were made this year within that. Can I get some of your reflections on that and how you think that that narrative may change going forward as more work is done to actually develop more data? And
yeah, so I think this has been a good piece of work. It's taken some time, obviously, it's been led on by the Fraser Valander Institute, and it's a joint piece of work between government and Parliament. I'm very keen to make sure there's much greater transparency around spend on across government on meeting our climate change targets as well. And you can see from the Strand 1 work that this year, if you take the carbon taxonomy that's been used, you can see that the proportion of spend in low carbon has increased. Well, the proportion of spend in high carbon factors has actually declined. So we're starting to get greater transparency around that. I think the challenge for, and I think the high level Strand 1 work that we have this year provides a bit more detail and overview of how we are spending our resources in tackling climate change. Both Strands 2 and Strands 3 will give us much more detail. But what it will also do is it will make it much more bespoke to individual portfolios. So I'm conscious that a lot of the burden falls on this committee when it comes to climate change. However, the Economy Committee, I would have thought, would have a particular interest in what's happening within the economy portfolio in investing and tackling climate change. Likewise, other portfolios as well. So it's important that we get, I think Strand 2 and Strand 3 will deliver for us, is that level of detail that individual committees beyond this committee will be able to see much clearer exactly what an individual portfolio is doing in order to help to deliver on our climate change targets and how it's investing and funding to help to support that as well. Mm-hmm. And that's what Strand 2 and 3 should help to deliver. Yeah. But I think Strand 1 has been helpful being applied to this budget, but there's clearly more we need to do, and that will be done over the course of this year.
Yeah. So in terms of Strand 2 then, that taxonomy, I mean, it kind of feels a bit rough and ready at the moment, and it's very much restricted, I think, to capital rather than looking at resource spend and what resource spend does. I'm just sort of wondering, like, with the future taxonomy, this will be the next big addition to the budget process, the next tool, I guess, that committees like this will have. It's going to have quite a bigger breadth covering both capital and resource, but spend. But I'm just wondering what kind of depth it can get into. I mean, is it going to be possible for us to look at individual capital infrastructure projects and say, oh, we can see now not just what the climate impact will be in terms of construction, but we can see what that contributes in terms of net zero, and there's a clarity there, an appropriate level of budget spend, so that we can actually get our heads around the direction of travel of spending, but also, what the choices have been within that.
Okay, I think we'll have to wait to see the work that's taken forward over the course of the year, and whether whether we're able to break things down to the level that you're referring to. Not just the actual capital, the capital investment programme, right down to the construction elements of it, etc. I suppose my answer to that is I don't know just now, and we'll have to see how that work is developed and taken forward in Strand 2 and Strand 3. The intention is that Strand 2 will expand the taxonomy and will give you more data, more understanding to provide much greater scrutiny of what's happening in different parts of the government and its spend in tackling climate change. So Strand 2 should give us an extra layer of will give us an extra depth of understanding, or committees an extra depth of understanding on that. And obviously, Strand 3 is to give us the net zero assessment so that we can have that level of assessment. And I think this is going to be really important. And again, on the back of the Committee on Climate Change report at the end of last year about having much clearer, much greater transparency between policy options, choices and their impact, I think it's important we've got that in the budget, that you can see that where we're spending and investing, how that's impacting on climate change. So between Strand 2 and Strand 3, I would hope we have got a much greater level of detail. How granular that will be, I don't know, because I'm conscious this is a new area. It's been developed and managed. I think the more granular it is, the better. And I think it will help us all in scrutinising the budget and in policy decisions that we take forward. So I would hope that we will get we'll get a level of detail that committees feel is sufficient for them to properly scrutinise the overall budget allocations.
Yeah. No, and I appreciate that work with Strand 2 will then be taken forward in Strand 3 to give that much more granularity. I mean, you mentioned there the climate change plan and the recommendation from the climate change committee that they need to see explicitly within the next climate change plan that we develop this year what the carbon impact will be of certain policies. I'm wondering if that gives us an earlier opportunity to, in particular, take things that will go into the draft climate change plan and assess those through the budget process, because if the plan is having to be very clear on what the carbon impact of policies will be, surely it would be relatively simple to extrapolate from that and say, well, okay, and if we're spending on this particular policy in a given year, then this is what the climate impact will be. Does that give us a starting point with the climate change plan this year to really start to build some of that work into the budget so we can see a follow through from the plan right the way through into spend?
I think so. I think the two of these come together. They might not be entirely aligned time-wise, but I think the two of these come together in a way that I think will be helpful in providing that level of scrutiny. I think if I was... I very much hope that we'll be in a position with the climate change plan update being published, the draft being published later this year, that with... if we have Strand 2 and Strand 3 in place for the next year's budget, that we'll be able to actually see exactly how does a budget deliver on the climate change plan, because the climate change plan is going to have to be much more detailed for different portfolio areas. So whether it be transport, whether it be agriculture, that we can set out very, very clearly the actions and the policy impact. And then the question will be is whether the Strand 2 and Strand 3 allow us to give that level of transparency in the budget process that align with that. And committees will then be in a position where they can clearly see whether there's what you're saying in your climate change plan fits with what you're actually setting out in your budget. That's ultimately where I think committees will want to get to, and the Parliament will want to get to, and I would certainly want to get to, so that we've got that transparency right across government.
I think that'd be very welcome. I mean, previous committees have looked at the climate change plan and found it absolutely impossible to work out where the cuts in emissions are coming from. At the time, I think we were told that the Times model that's used is just very complicated and so many interdependencies that it's impossible to work out. It would be good to see that transparency going forward. Recognise it's an area of international work, yeah. International interest. Fraser Allender report has highlighted a number of international examples. Is your department continuing to kind of make connections with other governments, including the New Zealand government, about their approach to this and how you can learn from each other? Because it feels like in some ways we're groundbreaking, but we're also learning from governments that have already broken some turf in this.
So it's a piece of work that's been taken forward on a joint basis, so with the finance committee, the DFM, and myself. The Fraser Allender are obviously the lead body that are taking this forward. I'm not sure what engagement they've had with other parliaments. I know from the briefing I had with them, they've been looking at international examples, although there are a limited number of international examples in this area. As well, but I don't know whether for Strand 2 and Strand 3 there's plans for further engagement around that, but I'm more than happy to take that away to find out whether there's further work with other countries around the approach they've taken to their budget process.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Mark. Liam, did you want to come in on that?
Very briefly, if I may, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, I just wonder if you might clarify something on budgeting for me. You see, I asked the Finance Secretary which budget line was going to be reduced to allocate, as he wishes to, a further £60.9 million for Hulls 801 and 802 in the draft budget. But his answer completely failed to address that point, so I'm still none the wiser. Now, given the pressures on your budget that the Deputy Convener rightly identified earlier, and given especially the transport aspect of your portfolio, are you able to help me understand, or help the committee understand, whether this £60.9 million is coming out of your budget or not?
I'm not sure what that £69 million is. I would have to see the answer that the DFM has provided, the Finance Secretary has provided, and to go away and check that for you. So I don't have that off the top of my head, unless Kerry can say some more about that.
Yeah, so it wouldn't specifically have come out from any particular part of the budget. So the way we did the capital process this time was there was a full reprioritisation. Obviously, you'll all be aware, rising inflation has meant cost increases across the board. So we've looked again at profile of capital spend, where there might have been some slippage in delivery because of some of the issues we were discussing earlier around labour shortages and material shortages. And so there was a full kind of reprioritisation exercise. So where there was additional budget required in other portfolios, that will have been for the DFM and Exchequer colleagues to have looked where there was availability, but it wouldn't have specifically been pinpointed to come from any one bit of the, for example, the NZ capital portfolio. So we wouldn't be able to give you a specific answer on as I say, which line that would have come from.
I'm very grateful for that response. Are you able, just Kerry Twyman, just to help me fully understand? So there was an exercise that looked across the portfolios and looked for, let's say, underspends. My word, you'll correct me if that isn't the appropriate word, and moved that money from those budget lines, from various different budget lines, into the £60.9 million. For the ferries. Is that a fair reflection on what you've said? Or?
Yeah, and probably not as specific as that. So it was probably more of a reassessment of where capital needed to be spent and what our effectively our requirements were for the year. And then based on that analysis, DFM, with assistance from Exchequer colleagues, would have looked at what the allocations were for each portfolio. So all we would have seen as a portfolio was what our allocation was for the 23-24 budget year. And we will have then assessed our priority commitments and our legal commitments against that and allocated. So as I said, I couldn't give you an answer as to how that work was done in the DG economy portfolio, which is where these costs sit. They will have received their own allocation and, as I say, allocated accordingly, including that £16.9 million.
Understand. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Liam. Ash, I think you want to come in with a question or two.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Scottish Government obviously set out its intention to grow renewable electricity production. And I'm wondering if you would agree with me that it would then be useful to improve infrastructure, and I'm thinking particularly in the north and the northeast of the country, obviously unable to sort of support that transition that we're talking about. So we know there's a number of roads that require upgrading, potentially for that purpose, but also for safety concerns as well. So I looked in the budget, so there's a budget line, motorways and trunk roads, that's standing at 801 million. Obviously that's a reduction on the allocation over the last 2 years. And the other one was road improvement budget line, and that's also showing a reduction. So I understand, obviously, we've had a conversation about the financial context, and I understand that, but I'm wondering if the Cabinet Secretary can set out for the committee what's being prioritised under that, obviously, with the reduction in budget, and what's being deprioritised.
Okay, so so there has been a shift, and it's a reflection of a challenging capital budget allocation which we're facing. Not only is there was there a reduction in capital allocation to the Scottish Government from the UK Government, we're also having to meet significant inflationary pressures within the capital allocations as well. So some aspects of construction inflation are operating at 17%+, which means that so not only is it a more challenging level of capital, it is also its buying power is weakened as well as a result of the significant inflationary pressures we have. So we've had to take out some to balance out some of this on the motorways and the trunk network. So there's been a reduction in the budget, which is about reprofiling some of the life cycle maintenance work that's carried out. There is also some reprofiling of some of the structural repairs programme that was being taken forward, and there are some aspects of capital land and works which has had to be reduced as well. There are a couple of areas that have continued to be a priority for us. So, for example, the A83, rest and be thankful, access road to Argyll and Bute continues to be a priority. So that's continued to have allocations to allow it to continue with the work that's been taken forward. And the area where there has been an increase in funding is actually in the road safety programme. Right. So to continue to build on the progress we're making around road safety measures. But it's by and large, it's a reflection of the challenges we've got with capital allocations. And this is effectively, it's not that these things won't happen, is that what's happening is that they're going to take place over a longer period of time, and we're having to stretch it out over a longer period of time around some of the life cycle maintenance work.
Okay, that's helpful. Would you be able to share that next level down of detail with the committee so that we were able to have a look?
Yeah, I'm happy to provide any further information that would be useful.
Great, thank you.
Yeah.
Thanks, Convener.
Thank you very much. I'm just looking around the table to see if there's any other questions. I've got a couple of questions. If there's no other questions, I'll try on mine. First of all, before I ask my first one, I'd like to remind the committee that I have an interest in land and in farming partnership because my question relates to trees and therefore land use. Cabinet Secretary, you said in your opening statement that you were looking to increase the amount of area planted. Could you just explain to me how your figures will achieve that, please?
So the additional allocations which we've made this year for the tree planting programme, as I mentioned, is to see 16,500 hectares of tree planting this year, which is going to be taken forward by Forest and Land Scotland as part of the programme. When you ask me specifically how we're going to achieve that, do you mean in terms of areas or?
Well, I'm asking how the budget that you've set for that, which I believe is in this year, is just shy of 103 million, will achieve that planting growth of 16,500 hectares.
It's a combination of that. So there's an additional allocation in there for part of the forestry programme to help to support the delivery of that. So it's a combination of their existing budget and the additional allocation which we've made. You know, Simon can maybe say a wee bit more from a forestry point of view in terms of how exactly they're going to do that for Simon.
Yep, thank you. So for the numbers you refer to, 102 million, that's just funding for Scottish Forestry. And within that number, the Woodland Grant Scheme, which they administer, is approximately 77 million next year. So that's growth of around 11% compared to this year. And it's through that growth and through the wider actions that Scottish Forestry and the separate funding that Forest and Land Scotland receive that we would seek to achieve those targets.
Sorry, Simon, you've now confused me. My understanding that there was 102.3 million set aside for Scottish Forestry and Forest Land Scotland was set aside £23.7 million, bringing a total of £126 million into that area. So yes. Is that what you just said?
Sorry, that's correct, yes.
So those figures are correct?
Yes.
OK, so my question is that, and planting is really important to reach net zero, and we're at a stage by 2035 where we won't have enough harvested timber in this country to meet the demands of the sawmills within this country for building and other materials. And therefore, in the last 8 years, we've only met the planting targets 1 year in the last 8 years. The increase that you have projected in the budget for forestry planting actually is a decrease per hectare. It's about a 10% decrease per hectare on the actual cost for last year's budget. So how, if there is a decrease per hectare in the amount of money for planting, are we going to increase planting when costs have obviously gone up?
Well, the expectation from the discussion we've had with Forest Land Scotland is that it can be managed within that budget settlement we've provided, meeting the 16,500 hectare target.
I have to say I'm slightly concerned if that is the expectation on the fact that they failed to meet any of the planting targets with the budgets that they've achieved. So if you're actually cutting the money per hectare, you must actually be reducing the amount of hectares that will be planted, because people are not going to plant less, more for less when costs have gone up.
Well, from the budget allocation we've made to for this particular ailment is that, and the discussion we've had with Scottish Land and Forestry, is that their expectation is that they can meet that target of 16,500.
Well, Cabinet Secretary, we could argue whether that's going to be achieved or not. Time will tell in a year's time.
It will.
We will see whether we've reached the 16,500 hectares that are planned. If I can move then to railways. The cost for the railways running the railways has gone up. I just wondered, on the basis that the major public transport projects budget has gone down, the rail franchise costs have gone up, and rail infrastructure has only gone marginally up. Are you comfortable that the costs of £1.4 billion is going to be sufficient to run the railways with the fares reduction, peak fares reduction, you're saying, and all the other costs with passenger numbers coming down?
Well, passenger numbers they've increased, but they haven't returned to pre-pandemic levels. So, and it's just to emphasise, it's a pilot we're running on at peak fares. So it's the £50 million to run a pilot for 6 months on a particular route or routes to test out whether peak fares, whether removing peak fares has an impact on people's travelling behaviour on the railway network. It's not removing them from across the network.
Well, it might be a pilot, but it's going to cost £50 million. That's the estimate we've told. And I'm asking if that's within the budget of £1.4 billion.
Yes, yeah, that £50 million is within that. But the £50 million is for the purpose of the pilot. So specifically, it would cost more than that to remove peak fares from across the whole of the network. So before arriving at a policy decision on whether we were to remove the peak fares from across the whole of the network, we would have to look at the cost of that and then whether there was budget allocation that could actually provide for that. So what's happened on our railway, so we haven't had the patronage return level, so the fare box has not returned to the pre-pandemic levels that we've had, which is why we're having to put additional investment in to help to support both the ScotRail and also the Caledonian Sleeper. And there's budget allocation in the £1.4 billion to achieve that. The cost base of rail has increased, so the fixed rail network charges have increased from Network Rail, which is having an additional cost impact. There's budget allocation within the £1.4 billion to meet that additional cost that we're facing as well. And there's also provision for continuing with the a level of enhancements. So, for example, at Thornton, Leavenmouth, etc., so their projects can continue. What there will not be, given the existing capital constraints that we're facing, is there will not necessarily be in the future the same level of enhancements and expansion of the rail network that some people may wish to see happening, because there's just not the capital provision to be able to do that. So to meet what we have to over the next financial year, the budget allocation we believe is sufficient to achieve that. But it is meaning it is having to deal with a significant number of inflationary pressures from both the cost base and also from the fixed access charges from Network Rail, which we're having to meet as well.
So I'm slightly confused, Cabinet Secretary. What was the income from rail tickets on the railways last year?
I don't have that information before me. We'd have to check that for you and come back to you.
Okay, so I don't see that figure in the budget. So what you're saying in one breath is that you're going to bear the costs for the loss of income out of the existing budget, but you're not showing the income from the tickets within the budget. Kerry wants to come in.
So the line that you see for the rail franchise subsidy is effectively a net figure. It's the net subsidy that we provide to ScotRail, which covers effectively their costs net of any revenue that comes in, and that will be ticket revenue, but also revenue associated with some of their properties and things. And then also that will include the fixed track access charges that the Cabinet Secretary has referred to that are paid directly from ScotRail across to Network Rail. So as I say, that is a net figure. So what we have done within that figure, you will see the 15 million has gone directly into that subsidy line to cover the loss of income that we anticipate from the peak fares pilot. It is also includes an uplift for ScotRail themselves to cover inflationary pressures, and then includes an uplift, as we've discussed, for those fixed track access charges where they're linked to inflation.
Okay, so just following that back, the franchise charges before that would have been considerably less than the figure shown in this year's budget.
Indeed, because revenue would have been much
was
higher.
It? Was it?
Yes.
You are confident. Perhaps I'll need to look back at those figures. But I mean, I cannot find roughly where the £184 million in ticket revenue is going into, but you're saying it's offset in there.
Exactly. So if you were to look at ScotRail Trains' accounts, you will see within those accounts specifically their costs laid out and revenue coming in and that net figure, which then effectively, as I say, is covered with a subsidy from the Scottish Government along with the fixed track access charges and various other elements.
Okay, so if I look at the 2019 accounts where you know, we're not... The 184 million is... basically a 60% reduction on what they were receiving in 2019 on the basis that we've lost 40% of passengers, according to the figures that we have. So I'll need to follow those figures through and I'll maybe take that back with the Cabinet Secretary. Yep. Just then on that basis, Cabinet Secretary, and on the basis that it's actually costing us more to run the railway and we've got slightly less services, do you think the public performance measure for the railways is sufficiently at a high standard at today's date?
So I think it's important, though, just to correct something here. We've got reduced services, as is the case, right across the whole of the UK because of reduced demand. So there's no point running empty trains or trains that are not being utilised. So it's not because we have chosen to reduce services, it's because of lack of demand. So if patronage returns to pre-pandemic levels, we were going through a process of prior to the pandemic, we were actually ramping up services. We were delivering more services per day than we had historically. So there was an expansion of the rail network and the frequency of services. What we've had to do, obviously, during the pandemic is ramp all that down. But because patronage has not returned to its normal levels, is that there is no point running what they often refer to as ghost trains. Is it trains that no one's on that previously, prior to the pandemic, would have brought in revenue? So that's what's happening.
Sorry, and I totally take that point. There's no point running empty services, but the fact if you're running less services, the railways are less crowded, so there's more chance that you should meet the PPM. And my question is, are you reaching a satisfactory PPM with the budget that you've got?
So if you look at PPM, very often PPM is not closely associated with the financing of frequency of services. PPM will often be affected by infrastructure impact on the operation of rail services, or it could be on staffing levels. So I'm confident that we have, in terms of resource allocation, sufficient funding for ScotRail to be able to staff the services sufficiently. However, as you will know historically in this committee, if you look at the biggest impact on PPM, it's infrastructure failure that has a mapped impact on it. The The question might then be is whether there's sufficient investment going into infrastructure in order to reduce the impact, the adverse impact that has on PPM. And that continues to be an issue. Now, my view is that I actually think that Network Rail can do much more in terms of value for money in for the level of investment that goes into and the costs associated with infrastructure investment in the rail services. But the key factor for anyone who, you know, in terms of detail around the rail industry, is that the biggest impact on PPM is infrastructure failure. And that requires the investment from Network Rail to try to help to reduce that, not just in terms of bringing in new technology and updating, digitalising systems, but also making sure there is a proper maintenance programme that helps to reduce the risk of failure. Now, is there more we can do to try to help to achieve PPM? Then, yes. You know, one of the biggest impacts that we'll have in PPM just now will be around industrial action, which we're having an impact on it. But I'm confident from a ScotRail point of view that we are making investment that allows them to be able to operate the level of services that there's a demand for, and also to have the staffing levels to be able to achieve that. But I still think there's more can be done in getting greater efficiency out of Network Rail around infrastructure investment.
Okay, so my problem is, Cabinet Secretary, that on the 21st of February 2019, the First Minister very much said that the ScotRail franchise should be judged on passenger satisfaction targets, PPM. Hamza Youssef in the 26th of June said that the set of targets contained in the ScotRail franchise is a challenging but realistic contractual regime to ensure that the punctuality of our rail service is at the forefront of ScotRail's priorities, therefore putting the pressure on the franchise based on PPM. And it was on the very fact that it didn't meet its PPM, one of the reasons for its nationalisation. The problem is that if I look at the PPM performance of the railways in November, December, it's 86.2, which is lower than the ScotRail performance in the same period in 2019, where they were running more services and achieving a better result. So I have to question whether this budget is realistic and whether passengers are getting value for money.
I think you're confusing a number of different things here. So PPM is not measuring passenger satisfaction, it's measuring punctuality of the train service. So there's a passenger satisfaction survey that takes place, I think it's every year that ScotRail run that through, and I think it may be through Transport Focus Scotland that they run it. I need to come back to you with the exact detail on that. PPM isn't measuring passenger satisfaction. Now, I recognise that a lot of passenger satisfaction will be linked into the punctuality of the train service. But look, there's a real danger that if you were to compare January's performance in PPM this year with January's performance in PPM in 2022, there are a whole range of different factors that can have an impact on that. That's not about resourcing. So it could be adverse weather that had an impact on it. It could be industrial action that was taking place at the time. Events that are largely out with the control of the rail network. So making a comparison like that, I think to some degree is actually not meaningful. So if you look over the course of a year in terms of PPM performances, you will see that there will be months where it's more challenging than others. So the winter months are traditionally more challenging because of weather events, the impact that has on the rail infrastructure, which cause problems for Network Rail, whether it be freezing points, whether it be issues around slippage on the rail network, which then has an impact on trains performing. The vast majority of impact on ScotRail's PPM is due to infrastructure challenges, rather than it being lack of rolling stock being available
Cabinet Secretary, if I can just come back in. I understand that the public performance measure, the PPM, shows the percentage of trains which ran their entire journey, calling at all scheduled stations, arriving at their terminating station within 5 minutes or 10 minutes for long-distance services. I absolutely understand that. But the problem is you are running less trains on a service that therefore is less crowded, and you are getting a worse performance than Abellio was. And I'm just asking if that's acceptable to you.
No, it's not acceptable.
With an increasing budget.
The reason a large part of that is because of infrastructure failures on the part of Network Rail. That's the biggest. That has the biggest impact on operating the rail network. There's no getting away from that. It's standard understanding within the industry and recognised within the industry. So if you look at, if you do an analysis of looking at the majority of the factors that have an adverse impact on PPM performance, it'll be due to infrastructure matters.
Well, I should go
so
back.
So what I would say to you is that there is a continued failure for Network Rail to provide the level of resilience and demand that's necessary in order to get the level of PPM performances that operators can have. So if you look
and
back,
who runs Network Rail in Scotland?
Well,
who
runs Network? Let me finish this point. It's a very good example of it, though. Is that if you remember the time when we had difficulty with the HSTs coming in, because WebTech, who were responsible for the refurbishment of the high-speed passenger trains, were way behind in the programme. It had an impact on the availability of seats on particular routes, which led to overcrowding and challenges and all that. That was a ScotRail problem, because it was about rolling stock and being able to have seats available. However, when it comes to things like points, line challenges, etc., it falls to infrastructure. And most people in the industry know that. Right now, from a ScotRail point of view, it's not a rolling stock challenge that it's got. It's not a crewing challenge that it's got. It's an infrastructure challenge that it's got. And that infrastructure challenge lies with Network Rail and what I think is still an unacceptable level of performance here in Scotland, because they do not make the level of investment in Scotland that I think is reflective of running a national railway, because they view it as being a region.
Okay.
And it's treated as a region in terms of its investment programme.
Is Alex Hines still on the board of Network Rail and runs he's, it for still, Network Rail still, Scotland, for which he gets a salary? Yeah.
He's employed by Network Rail. So he's employed by Network Rail. He's on the board of ScotRail, because they are the major infrastructure provider to ScotRail. But he works for and is employed by Network Rail, not by ScotRail.
Thank you. I'm going to leave it there. Are there any other questions around the table? There aren't. So, first of all, I'd like to thank you all for taking part in today's session. And that concludes our part of the public meeting. And we're now going to go into private session. Could I ask committee members to be back here at 11:30? And we're now moving to private session.